Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Season 2 of Upkeep Wrap-Up / Stats video. Today, we're going to be talking a little bit about the season. Who won the most? What colors did we play? How bad does Steven stink at the game? Stuff like that. So it was a really fun season. If you missed any games, either before or after this video, go check out any episodes you might have missed. We played quite a few. This was episodes 18 through 34 of our show. That's kind of insane, guys. I need a nap. But let's go ahead and go around the circle and say your name just to remind the viewers.
My name is Steven.
Preston.
Morgan.
Tommy.
Jason.
All right, boys. So as we head into this wrap-up / stats video, does anyone have a prediction on who won the most this season?
We already know that.
Just raw number?
Raw number.
Raw number of games.
Why don't
not
everybody
percentage.
Say it at the same time on the count of three who they think won the most games? Ready?
I'm
one,
not doing that.
Two, three. Jason.
Yeah!
I'm not boosting his ego anymore.
So the answer.
He already doesn't let us live it down.
So the answer is actually it's a tie between Jason and I.
Let's go, Morgan!
Yeah, boy. And it's because we did the Outlaws of Thunder Junction episode, and I came back and stole one in that episode. So he and I both won five times. Steven came in and won four games, though, right behind us. Tommy won two, and Preston with a... I forgot to write it. I think it was one.
I thought it was zero for a second.
No, I'm pretty sure it was one. I just forgot to write. I'll have to fix that on the slide before I show people at home. And then for reference, here's last season. I took the most wins last season. Preston and Jason were tied with three, Steven with two, Tommy with zilch. So Tommy, good improvement.
Wait. How does that work? I wasn't in Revenge Week last season.
Because I won Revenge Week.
Oh, that makes sense now. Yeah. That makes sense now.
So, does that surprise anyone? Is there anyone feeling good about maybe some just improvement from last season?
I will say
season?
I am surprised that Preston won only one game. That is a bit surprising to me.
Yeah, especially because you won three last season. So, what happened? Did you just drop the ball?
No, you guys are just mean to me.
Okay.
Technically, he won two games, because one of the episodes was we play his decks.
Well, I don't know.
No.
You and I definitely had improvements, though.
Yes.
Oh, you had a 400% improvement.
I had a literal infinity percent improvement, because
zero wins.
Zero times anything is zero, so...
I did feel like at a couple of games your threat assessment was not the best, and I think that that might have been a contributing factor.
Also, how many times did you kill yourself? At least two.
I think it was three.
Yeah, but that was, two or three.
Those were more like, you know,
I'm not going to act
against the wall.
But I mean, it's like, he killed himself. He didn't, you know.
More than accidentally killed.
It was his last resort.
Yeah.
So, we all know, though, that most wins doesn't really matter, right? Because we don't all play the same number of games. What actually matters is best win rate. So, if we go to jump into that, Jason is at number one. He won five of the 13 games he was in, so that's a 38% win rate. I came up in second with five out of 15 games, that's a 33. Steven with 4 out of 14, that's 28%. Tommy with 2 out of 12, that's 16%. And Preston, 1 out of 14. Okay, it was 1, which is about 7%. And then I have last season's stats off to the side. So roughly the same, only difference is that, you know, Preston ended up dropping from where he was last season. But otherwise, our ranking has stayed the same. But overall, how do you guys feel about your win percentages? I would say that Jason, I, and Steven are all like... You know, I think anything above 25% is like, hey, that's pretty good. Because if, let's say that everyone's completely on an even playing field, 25% is what you expect in a four-player game.
Yeah.
Tommy specifically, good job for coming back from zero wins last season. So.
I did it.
So that's pretty good. But, you know, Preston, there's always the future.
I'm just going to start bringing CDH decks every time.
That's why we kill you first. No.
All right, so we have... Measured before early soul rings, everyone's jokes are like, oh, we played a turn one soul ring, team up on them. Well, how often does that actually translate to a win? So we went ahead and went in every time that there was fast mana, so soul ring, mana crypt. I think those were the only two cards that we kept track of. If there was one on turn one through three, did that have an impact on whether or not you won? And the win rate of that went down from last season. I'll leave this up on screen for anyone who wants to read it. But this season, if you had a turn one through three fast mana, you had about a 27% win rate, whereas last season was a 43% win rate. So quite a bit down. This means a few things to me. Well, one, we had a longer season this season, so I feel like this is probably more accurate. This is probably a little bit more of what people expect. I would say that that probably evens out to it maybe doesn't actually matter, because maybe people just team up on you.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know. Do you guys think anything of that statistic, or maybe just from how it's changed from last season?
I mean, we had a longer season, and we had, just looking at the slide, there were more games that had an instance of fast mana than last season. It stands to reason that, yeah, it would more or less evens it out and gives a better idea of how it actually affects your win rate, because there's more data to pull from. So
I think that analyzing these type of statistics from an objective point of view isn't really going to be the best way to understand what the data tells you, because I do think that's for specific things like that. It's a little bit more playgroup specific.
Mm-hmm.
It kind of goes into what you're saying, what you said, Morgan. You know, do people just target you? Kind of depends on the playgroup, you know? I don't know that it necessarily matters if you play a Sol Ring turn one or not. I think what matters more is, what deck are you playing when you play that Sol Ring turn one?
And
like,
general,
how much benefit are you going to get by having that on the battlefield early, as opposed to every other commander that's on the table? How much more of an advantage do you have from having that than the other decks might have if they had it?
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's definitely one of those stats that's more game-specific than it is a general stat to go by.
Anything to add, Estavi?
No.
Okay. So what about going first, all right? In 1v1 formats, going first actually has a high likelihood of increasing your win percentage. This is something that we've been tracking for a long time, and we figured, hey, that's probably true in Commander as well. And last season, we saw that going first meant you had a 33% chance of winning. Guess what, boys? Do you think that went up or down?
I think it stayed the same.
Probably similar.
Yeah, I think it stayed pretty similar.
Look at these guys stealing my opinion.
I'd say more.
Steven's right. We are up to a 41% win rate. It went up quite a bit whether or not you went first. So this doesn't really surprise me, just because the format has been power crept even just in the last year. So I guess it doesn't surprise me.
Wow, Cassina, three of the five games that I won, I went first.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I really am the arena shuffler and the arena dice roller, I guess, dude.
New house rule. Jason always goes fourth.
Especially, you really are the arena shuffler, because you also run like half as many lands as everyone else, and you always have enough to play the game. You might not hit every land drop in the game, but you will hit enough to play the game.
Yeah, you never get just straight screwed on mana.
I mean, you know, the win percentage speaks for itself. I hit enough lands to win.
So. Yeah, exactly.
All right, so that's enough about winning and losing and all that crap.
Well,
let's go ahead.
For
and
you
talk
at home,
about...
it is. For us here, he'll never let us live it down.
No. He brings it up every chance he gets, even on the podcast.
Well, now you guys are making me sound like a.
We're not doing any of that.
We are speaking facts.
So let's go ahead and talk about something that I think is a little bit more fun and a little more exciting, which is the diversity of the decks that we played on the show. So we're going to go ahead and talk about what colors we played the most. We did this last season as well. Jason, we'll go in alphabetical order, starting with you. You played blue and green 7 times, white 6 times, and red and black 5 times. And then we have... shown here, the color pairs, the only repeat you had was Selesnya, and that was because you had a pre-con, and that's what you did for the Pauper deck game. So that was your only repeat. But very nice, even spread, which you had last season as well, but you played about twice as many games this season, so it's nice that you were able to keep that up.
You wouldn't know this from the stats, but black is actually my favorite color to play. But I just like to, especially for the channel, trying to keep things interesting, I want to play, you know, a wide variety of different things. I don't want to stick to necessarily one category or one style of play or one color or anything like that, because I want to make it interesting for not only you guys, but I don't want you guys to get bored of playing Magic with me. Maybe annoyed when I talk about how much I win, but you know, I want you to have fun in the game.
I want to make things interesting, so I played a lot of Simic this season.
What was most interesting to me is that black was your most played color last season, and this season it was tied for your least played color. So that was kind
of
interesting.
I took the perspective last season of like, okay, I played white the least, you know, I played black the most. Let me try and play some decks that maybe I wouldn't have initially chosen to play for myself, just to kind of mix things up, keep things in a good mix.
Yeah, for sure. So here are mine. I played 15 games this season. I played black 9 times, green and white I played 8, red 6, blue 5. Blue being at the bottom was kind of surprising to me, but here's my color combinations. Esper, I don't know what the second Esper... Oh, I played Quaza because I brought it back for Revenge Week. And then Abzan, I played 3 times. I played it for Custom Commander, when I played Jason's deck, and when I played my Human Typal deck. I think if I had realized I was going to be playing Abzan that much, I probably would have done something different for the Custom Commanders episode, or maybe I would have picked a different one of your decks, because I know originally I was going to pick your Gandalf the Grey deck, so maybe I would have stuck with that if I had known that it was going to be skewed that much. But I'm glad that black ended up my top color this season, because it was my bottom color last season, and it's also my favorite color to play, so I was happy to have that shift. I feel like this is a little bit more justice to how I feel. So blue being at the bottom was still kind of weird to me, but you know, there's always going to be a little bit of randomness in this, because we have to play certain decks for certain themes, so that we don't have 100% say in this, but I do feel like this is fairly accurate to our play patterns. All right, Preston, you played in 14 of the games this season. You played white 9 times, go figure, blue 8, black and red 7, and green 6. So I think the most interesting, well, I think white being your number one makes sense. You really like
it's
playing white.
It's my favorite color at this point, mm-hmm.
Yeah,
for sure.
Mm-hmm. Green being at the bottom is a little bit interesting, I suppose. As far as your repeats and color combinations, you played Wooburg 3 times. That's because you brought Slivers back for Revenge Week,
yeah.
And your custom commander was Wooburg as well. You also had repeats and Azorius and Orzhov. How do you think green ended up at the bottom? Because I associate you as, like, white's your number one, but I would say green's your number two, so...
I think it's because green used to... Obviously, I was very much the love me a big green stompy deck back when we were first starting playing, so... As time has gone on, I've just tried to make myself do some other stuff, so green has naturally just fallen down a bit. I still love it. I still enjoy what it brings to the games, but I've tried to push myself more to some of the other colors to appreciate it more.
Yeah. Well, guys, this is where we have seen true, unadulterated improvement.
Oh, yeah?
This is Steven, all right? So last season, we need to...
I'm expecting pretty much a complete 180 from last season.
It's pretty dang close to that. So last season, we gave Steven a little bit of crap. He wasn't here for the season wrap-up video last season, but we gave him crap anyways, because he played 11 games. He only played white twice, and those were in his Wooburg decks. So that doesn't even really count. And of those 11 games, 9 of the decks had green. And we're like, yo, Steven, you can't do that, bro. So this season, he came back with a vengeance, all right? Of the 14 games that Steven played, he played blue 8 times, white and black 7 times, red 5 times, and green last.
Four times.
Good job, Steven.
Good job, Steven.
So happy.
You did
I played it. More decks. And a couple of those were pre-cons with
green. I was going to say.
So your repeats where you played Orzhov 3 times, Dimir twice, Simic twice, Jeskai twice. So what kind of led to the downfall of green? I mean, I assume it's still your favorite color, but...
It is still my favorite color. I would say it's a two-way tie between black and blue. So for my second favorite. So the fact that black and blue are my most played this season doesn't surprise me. I mostly just wanted to build a bigger variety of decks this season, and that's the main reason.
I imagine our shaming might have had something to do with it. Maybe.
Maybe a little.
If not subconsciously, at least.
Nine out of 11's a lot.
A lot?
I like it. So
it's most.
Yeah.
It's most.
It's most.
But I do like green, so...
There's nothing wrong with having a favorite color, but it's always good to branch out and
try new
things.
And that's what I did this season.
I mean, I wanted to do that.
All right, and then we have, finally, with Tommy. Tommy played 12 games this season. He had black at number one with 8 games, white, blue, and red all tied with 7, and then also green at last with 4. His repeats were he played Wooburg twice, and he had... Orzhov twice, Wooburg twice from you played Goshentai, and then you
Goshentai
played
Ur-Dragon.
Ur-Dragon, yep. When we played Jason's decks. What was your Orzhov? Or your Orzhov decks?
That's black-white, right?
Yes.
Clavileño. Clavileño I played twice. Yeah,
yes,
so.
That's right.
Yep.
This fits well in my mind because I associate, mostly because of Ishin, but even though you haven't played Ishin this season, I associate that deck with you. I associate the aggro colors.
I mean, he's my favorite commander, so
yeah, I associate the aggro colors with you. So that all fits with me. Was there anything there that surprised you, or is that? Yep, makes sense.
I mean, that kind of makes sense. Wait, was Mardu on there? Because I played.
You did play a Mardu deck.
Okay, I didn't see it at first. Sorry.
Yes, you did play
because that was Edgar. Mardu is probably like my favorite wedge. I would probably agree with most of the guys that black is probably my favorite color to play.
Right, we need to get you a Gruul deck. I think you'd like that.
Oh yeah, that's one thing I do want to build. I do not have a Gruul deck, and
a
I don't
green
have
green aggressive deck.
Yeah, I don't have. Oh. I mean, yeah, I don't have any. I don't have Gruul. I don't have Golgari. Those are like two that I really want
to
play.
We need to build this guy a Domri deck.
No, we
need to get this guy a Tovelar deck.
Yes, Steven.
We're just gonna grow one the pack of us. Of werewolves.
One of us. One of us.
Furries.
So last Damn season, Jason asked me to keep track of some commander specific. Stats. So I kept track of two specifically. If you were first to play your commander, did that mean you won? And then the other one was how many times did you cast your commander, and did that have an impact on whether or not you won the game? I didn't have a good way to fit these into the slides, so I'll just have to have this show up in a weird way on screen. But first to player commanders, Jason won two of the three games that he did that. Preston won one of the six games he did that.
Wow.
And then everyone else was like, not really. So I don't know if there's really much to make of that. What I kind of figured is you don't want to just run your commander out.
Not
Preston seemed to do that more. Six times was the first to play his commander in six of the games, and that only worked out for him once. So maybe that's the kind of commanders Preston plays. Maybe that's the timing. I don't really know. For me, I don't really know what to make of this stat. But Jason asked me to keep track of it.
It just depends largely on just your commander and the style. That's just what your deck wants to do and how quickly you need your commander out.
Yeah, I don't know if this stat really means much, if I'm being honest. Because I only played my commander once first, and there were definitely games I could have more than that. Did you guys have any feedback on that, or is it just like, numbers?
It shows an interesting thing. Preston was in a position to play his commander first. It seemed a lot more than the rest of us. Now, is that because his mana base is just better than ours, or is he just playing lower cost commanders on average than everybody else? So
not that one.
See, I wouldn't think so.
Yeah, right, yeah.
It's because I love Commander more than the rest of you. I understand the spirit of the format better than all of you. It's why I get punished. I am the genius.
No, that's not how this works.
Actually incorrect.
I don't know. I mean, it was an interesting stat that I thought about, and you know, I can't think of a whole lot of intriguing information to glean from the data at this particular moment. But
no, I think it's an interesting stat. But in the end, I don't think it's like that impactful.
I don't think it's game changing. No. It's just interesting. I do think it's interesting that Preston did it six times and it only worked out for him once.
Yeah.
And I did it three times and it worked out for me twice. So that's like a 66% success rate versus what is 1 divided by 6? What is 1/6?
Like 17 point something percent,
roughly. This is more of a personal thing for me, but when I build a commander deck, I tend to shy away from decks and builds that do not work unless your commander is on the battlefield.
Right.
It's part of the format is having the commander, so your commander should have an impact, it should be important, but I don't want to be completely shut down and completely useless unless my commander's on the battlefield. So I think that shows, at least for me, and this leads into the greater thing of just, it's more how you build the decks and what types of commanders you like to run, because I don't necessarily want to play my commander first, because I want to get at least a bit of a board state building to what I want to do, what I want the deck to do before my commander ever hits the battlefield. Because I feel like with having your commander in the command zone and being able to cast it multiple times, the earlier you cast it, almost to me it feels like that's not a huge target, but enough of a target to be like, okay, he cast his commander, that means he's probably pretty close to doing what his deck wants to do.
Well, there's two main kinds of commanders. There's the commanders that help you get to your main goal, and then there's the commanders that are the payoff for your main goal.
Mm-hmm.
And where that commander is on the curve will also have a big factor in how well it is at doing one of those two things.
Yeah, exactly.
But Preston and I were having this conversation earlier today, which is like, I agree. I think it's much, much better to have a deck that, a 99 that functions, whether or not your commander exists. Because your commander just, whether or not it's an arch enemy style commander, you know, you just incidentally will get commander attacks out of the games from time to time. Whether it's, you know, too many board wipes or Drainth Magistrate, who knows? There's times where you will not have access to your commander, even though it kind of looks like the eighth card in your hand or whatever. Mm-hmm. So your 99 should function whether or not your commander exists. So I think the style of... But part of the problem, too, is like it's harder to do that nowadays because Wizards has designed so many commanders that like the commander's in play, you do the thing, you get the thing. Mm-hmm. So it's so it's a self-fueling engine. Mm-hmm. So I think it's harder to avoid that nowadays with a lot of modern commander design.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But Preston was kind of on the other end of the scale. Did you have anything to add to that? You ran your commander out the most and won the least, so...
Yeah, those decks might be stronger, but mine holds the spirit of commander better, so I'm the better commander player for that reason.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, speaking of commander tax, here's a what I thought was a little bit of a more interesting stat. So the other stat that Jason had me look at was, how many times did you cast your commander, and did that have an impact on your game? So I'm just going to kind of skim through this. I think most of this is a whole lot of nonsense, but because I made sure to keep track of it for each specific episode, you will have a little bit more context if you are familiar with these episodes. I think if anything...
So go watch them.
Yeah, yeah. So go watch any episode you might maybe haven't seen. But I think in general, it's safe to say that the player who plays their commander the least is more likely to win. There's a couple outliers. There's a couple times where that's not true. Like, for instance, when we played Jason's decks and Steven had to play Felice six times.
And he still won.
So that's that one's an outlier. But for the most part, it seems like
I was waiting for you to get done with Jason's deck. I'm like, I know why I played Felice so many times.
That's so many times.
So context is important for a few reasons, because like we said, it's the kind of commander, right? Is your commander a payoff for already having your engine going, or does your commander help you get there? So that's important to keep in mind, right? And then the other context is, did you just not cast your commander until later in the game and then there just wasn't a board wipe? So there is context that's required there, but I think on average, it's probably safe to say that if you played your commander less, you were probably more likely to win. And I think that's a timing thing. But is that what you guys would have expected going into that?
I would not necessarily have expected that, because the way that I see our games go, a lot of board wipes happen. The person who won the games would have played their commander more than once, would have been what I thought, happened in each game. But thinking about it, it makes sense that if you only play your commander... If you play your commander fewer times than everybody else at the table, that probably means that your game plan was interrupted the least. Mm-hmm. It probably means that your board wasn't interacted with a whole lot, and you were able to just kind of do your thing. So looking at the stats now, after the season's over, that's kind of the way that I interpret the numbers.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I agree. Between that and the what kind of commander is it the payoff? Or
right,
yeah.
Right.
So I think those two things, I agree.
I think always you have to consider, no matter what stat you're looking at whenever you're talking about commander or even magic in general, you always have to look at what type of commander or deck you're playing. That's always going to be a determining factor.
Mm-hmm. Here's something else. We got game length, all right? So last season, our average game length was, it doesn't look like it to you guys because I'm really good at cutting out the fat that doesn't need to be there. Average game length last season was 1 hour 17 minutes.
Oh, there's no way it's that short.
There's no way.
So y'all expect that to have gone up, I assume?
Yeah.
Just a little bit. Can I take a guess?
I'm going to guess 125% longer. I'm going to guess, so what was it, an hour and what? How much?
It was 1 hour 17 was our average game length last season.
Oh, 2 hours and 10 minutes for sure is the average, I would say.
All right.
Yeah, so, I'd say at least 2 hours is average.
All right. It's also, last season, we also had an average of about 10 turns.
That also probably, almost doubled.
So I'm going to give you two numbers, because there's two games in specific that I think we have to be like, all right, let's not count that. All right.
We got outliers here.
Yeah. Christmas. So the straight up answer, if we actually averaged everything out,
every
was
single game,
2 hours and 5 minutes. With 13 turns. That was our actual average. But we have two outliers that we have to be like, oh, hold up, we can't count that. And that would be the Christmas episode, which was almost 4 hours, and it was 17 turns.
And it was also the only five-player game we had all season.
It wasn't five players for long.
And then the other...
No, but there's still five players.
The other outlier was the game where we played Jason's decks, which was 2 hours and 44 minutes. So it was, one of the longer games, but the reason it's an outlier is because it was 22 turns. That's why it has to be an outlier. So if we cut those two out, it actually didn't make as much of a change as you would think. The average game length without the outliers is still 1 hour 55, and the average turns was still 12. So not actually that much of a difference. It's also worth mentioning that the shortest games this season in time was the Halloween episode, which was an hour 14, which was 11 turns. And then the shortest game in turns was a tie at 9 turns with the least played colors, which was an hour 28, and the Revenge Week, which is an hour 16, which was the second shortest game as far as time goes. So, but that means on average we had several games that were over 2 hours, and there's a couple reasons for that. One, we were building new decks, so we were less familiar with them, playing decks that were outside of our play pattern, our normal play patterns. But we also played a lot of pre-cons.
Pre-cons, yeah.
And the other thing is we play a lot more board wipes than we used to.
Yep.
What do you guys think of the philosophy of pre-cons? How many board wipes should we be running? Blah, blah, blah. Because this seems ridiculous. I feel like our games almost doubling in average game length is ridiculous.
Yeah.
It makes my editing harder.
I think a lot of it has to do with just...
I mean, a lot much so this season, we're playing decks that we're not as familiar with. I think that's a big thing.
Mm-hmm.
And playing stuff that we may not be familiar with. Part of that is because we're playing like with pre-cons and stuff that like...
Yeah, we did play a lot of pre-cons this season.
I would say that it's probably... The reason that these games have gone longer this season, I would say, is probably more like we all just are more competitive this season. We got one season under our belt. We know how it all went down. We knew that this season was going to be longer and have more episodes, and we knew that we were going to be doing a lot more stuff, a lot more different themes, and we knew we were going to be playing more pre-cons. And so I think with that in mind, all of us just wanted to win, and so we tried harder to win. Mm-hmm. So I think that from last season to this season, I think we all kind of became, you know, casual tryhards, I would say.
Pre-cons were one of the bigger things that I think helped contribute to that, because by design, a set of pre-cons for an expansion set of Magic is meant to be ideally pretty evenly matched with each other. They don't want to print one that's way more powerful than the other for value reasons and for playability reasons. So when you pit those four decks against each other, there's going to be a lot of back and forth between each player because they're supposed to be, you know, by the numbers and by the designs, and they've been designing this game for a long time. They know what they're doing. It's going to be very evenly matched, and so you're not going to get those games where one person just pub stomps everybody. Yeah. Because they're all, the deck building is very evenly matched. And not only that, that even gets into the decks that we did build. If we were all building a new deck for the episode, we kind of we're pretty familiar with all of each other's deck building styles at this point. So we kind of know how to build it to be pretty evenly matched in the play group. So I think it's a good portion of it at least has to do with the fact that for a lot of the episodes, all of the decks we chosen were very evenly matched. And so that leads to longer games before someone finally comes out on top.
You made a good point because part of why games were shorter in season one was because we were still trying to get our footing. We were still trying to figure out what the right power level was for the show. So there were two games where I curb stomped people. Mm-hmm. There was a game last season where Preston curb stomped, right? So we just had a few imbalanced games where one person had a quick start and they ran away with the game. Yep. We did have a little bit of that in season one. Whereas we didn't have, I don't think we really had that at all in season two, really.
I mean, we
had some shorter games, but it wasn't
shorter
as
games,
brutal.
But yeah, I can't think of a single one that I was on or even ones that I wasn't on that I watched that it felt like one person was just dominating the entire game. Like,
I should have done how many board wipes did we see per game? Because I feel like there might be a direct correlation between how many board wipes there are to how long a game is.
Oh, yeah.
Because Preston is the kind of person, specifically...
I will make you kill me, and you will earn it.
Preston will see there is no light at the end of the tunnel. I have 3 cards in my hand, no cards, way to draw cards. All 3 of these cards are board wipes. I will just keep casting
them.
No,
one of them will be O'Ketcher's Last Mercy.
Okay, yeah. So... Point being is that we have, you know, a little bit of pettiness where we just want to drag the games out and make Morgan's editing a little harder. So do you guys think that that's a factor? Do you think the board wipes are a factor? Because I feel like we're running more board wipes than we used to.
Board wipes are a factor without question.
Oh, yeah.
You clear the board, you force everyone at the table to reset. The only time it's going to be pretty insignificant is if you've got it down to 1v1. Wiping the board and forcing all 3 of them to have to kind of reset, even if it's just resetting, like, taking one turn to reset slows the game down so much.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, not only that, but I see a lot of... Not only the number of board wipes, but the type of board wipes. A lot of the the majority of the board wipes we run are very even board wipes. They affect everyone. They're not they're not your cyclonic rifts that are very one-sided of you guys get nothing, I keep everything, and now I win. You know, because those type of board wipes, they can end games very quickly.
Yeah.
And we don't run...
Well, even if you just have the board wipes where you can manipulate them so that they're not going to blow your deck out as much.
Yeah,
you
know? That's like, what I'm saying. Like, there's the ones one-sided
that, like,
ones.
Hit all... Like, if you're a token deck, you play the board wipes that say, hit all non-token creatures, right? Like, those kind of board wipes are obviously way better, but there are certain archetypes that don't have those kind of board wipes, so then you just have to play the catch-alls, and then... Everyone's just kind of screwed.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Another big thing is these two are just better at building decks now.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Jason and Tommy have both made such better decks than they used to.
You mean Steven?
That's what I meant.
Let's just say, Jason, Jason's
probably turned it down a little bit.
I had the best win percentage. What are you talking about?
No, I'm saying I think you might have actually calmed down from how you used to build decks.
Oh, yeah. Like, yeah. These two guys used to be a little more cutthroat. Yeah, yeah. That's true.
I would agree with that. I would agree with that. I'm not trying to break everyone's spirits every game anymore.
Just sometimes.
Only sometimes when it calls for it. Yeah. Sometimes, and you all know this too, sometimes there are just certain people in your playgroup, their spirit needs to be broken.
I don't even disagree with that. But speaking of which, you know, I don't want everyone else to feel bad. The last two seasons in a row, Jason and I have been at the top of the leaderboards, and I don't want everyone else to feel bad because they're still putting in good efforts, playing good games, have good showings of their cool decks, even if they don't win. So we're going to make sure that we have some honorable special awards, all right?
Oh, boy.
So we have best at playing other people's decks goes to Steven. All three games we had in season one, we had a game where everyone played one of my decks. And then this season we did that with Preston's decks and Jason's deck. Steven has won all three of those games. Steven, what's your secret?
I honestly just picked the deck that I just want to play the most. Like that,
and it just happens to be a strong
deck. It just happens to be the best one of that
honestly,
person's
decks. Yes.
Yeah.
All right, next up we have Preston at Most Unalivings. I tried to go back and verify, and it was kind of hard to figure it out. But I believe it was three times this season where you just went out on your own terms.
It's my favorite. I like doing that more than I like winning games of Magic.
Oh, it's so good. It's so good.
I will find a way to stop you from killing me, even if it's me pulling the trigger.
Yeah, exactly.
Only one that gets to kill me is me.
And then I did on accident on the season finale. So, and then finally, we have Tommy with the biggest comeback. He had zero wins in season one and got two this time. And I think overall this season, you just had a better showing. I think that's in part because you're more comfortable in the playgroup. Because when you started on the show, you had been playing Commander for less than a year, right?
Yeah, I'd been playing Commander, and by that extension, with you guys for, at that point, less than a year. So.
Yeah.
And if not, like, right at a year. It was, like, around that. So.
Yeah, and then you've also just, like Preston said, you've just also grown as a deck builder and stuff like that. So, yeah.
Before I started playing with you guys, I hadn't touched Magic in probably a decade.
Wow. Yeah.
Close to a decade. Last time I played before I played with you guys, I was in middle school.
Wow.
And I didn't start playing with you guys till after college. So, that's, you know.
Congratulations to all three of you guys with your special awards. I'm very proud of all of you. So, as we're kind of wrapping this video up, I want to know, what were some of your guys' favorite games, favorite themes? Are there any that you would maybe want to try again sometime? Any that you absolutely hated and please never do again? I'm just going to open that up. You guys take that wherever you want.
I'm probably ready to not play a five-player game on the channel again. Probably ready for that.
No, we need to do five-player Simic.
No.
But one of my absolute favorite moments from the season comes from that game.
Yes.
The moment that I died to Morgan.
That was funny.
It was incredible.
That was insane.
Because as soon as he played that card,
everyone trash talked
him. First thing I said was, oh, he's not going to do this game. There's no way he'll get that off this game. And it literally killed me with it. It was just perfect.
Perfect.
It was absolutely
karma.
Perfect.
Poetic.
Mm-hmm. And it's
beautiful.
And it's just kind of gone on as this joke in our group because I've played that deck a few more times and I've actually made that card the commander. And Jason, I still think, is the only person I've killed with it. So.
Dude, the second time that I played that against that deck, this was off the channel. The second time. So the first time, that's how I died. The second time, that's how I died.
I still haven't won with that deck, but I've killed Jason with it, so it's all that matters.
Deck's got my number. You gotta
start bringing it back every video next season.
Yeah. Every time that I could even like barely say that just fits like, the theme, I'm just gonna do it.
Any deck you have that has blue in it, just slide it in there. Yeah, you'll figure the rest
out
later.
We'll get there. What about the rest of you guys? Any favorite games, favorite themes, anything you don't want to do again?
One of my favorite moments was when you killed yourself in Revenge Week.
That was so tragic.
That was good.
That was hilarious.
I really have thought about cutting either Peer into the Abyss or Alhemert's Archive. I think I'm probably going to cut Alhemert's Archive just because it gets into these awkward lines where it obviously it's a very good, flavorful card with Quaza, but it creates these really awkward lines of play where my turns get way more complicated. I just kind of want to play Magic, man. So I might end up cutting it, but I haven't decided.
My favorite episodes are the ones where we don't play Commander. You know, it's the ones where, like, Plane Chase was really fun, Tiny Leaders, all of those ones. I want to do Two at a Giant at some point, hopefully.
That would be really fun.
The most successful episode from Season 2 was the Pauper Commander episode. So
I think that's interesting.
One of my other favorite moments from this season was from that episode, and it was at the end of that game when I was about to win on my turn, and I forget exactly what I did. And Morgan was like, okay, well, in response to that, I was like, whoa, you can't cast spells on my turn. And he's, oh, no, I forgot. And it was just that moment of, like, satisfied, like, you didn't say the magic word. Oh, it's another beautiful moment.
I had such inner turmoil at the end of that game because I got too excited because I was like, I think I got the win. I got too cocky with my attack, and I was like, oh no, I lost half my board. And then I had a removal spell for your commander, but I was just going to do it on your upkeep. And then it was too late because I forgot that I couldn't cast stuff during your turn. So that was quite tragic in multiple levels. So, but it was my fault. So it is what it was. But we had a lot of really good games. We had a lot of really great moments. And I agree. I think it would be fun to do more of the less traditional formats. You know, if we did more Pauper Commander, I really like that format. And it's cool that it's a cheap format, too, for the most part. So that makes it easier to open up the possibility of doing it more often. We did Tiny Leaders last season. That was a fun episode. We did Plane Chase last summer. That was fun. There's other alternate formats that we could always try out.
I think we should try Two-Headed Giants, and I think another fun one would be Arch Enemy.
Yeah.
If we did that. I think that'd be interesting.
Also, in the Pauper game, there's like 5 comments of people being like, did you know you're supposed to start with 30 life? Well, we know now.
Yeah, we didn't know that.
You can stop leaving that comment.
They didn't know that at the time.
Could you guys throw one more of there for me? I just, in case I forget. Please do it one more time.
Yeah. We had never played Pauper Commander before that game. So we like were like, oh, that is a format. It'd be cool if we tried it. And I'm sure there's probably like, you know, deck techs or like deck theory stuff or metagaming stuff that like we just don't know about. So like maybe there's cards that's like, why didn't you play that? Or why did you play this? Because we're just new to that format and we just didn't understand it. But the big one was you're supposed to start with 30 life and we didn't know that. But so hey, sorry!
The good cards in Pauper that we should have played, leave those in the comments so we know to play them next time.
Yeah, so I think it's very likely that we keep doing fun stuff like that. But we are going to be doing all sorts of crazy, wacky themes going forward. Now that we're going to be doing this once a month, we're going to be opening up to doing weirder themes. So we're pretty excited for it. Any final thoughts on season 2 of the show, guys?
In the same vein of, you know, me doing stuff that in turn, you know, makes Morgan sad, another favorite moment I had was in the Least Played Color episode where I flashed in Gandalf and then in turn flashed in the One Ring to save myself.
That was
super incredibly flavorful on my part. Loved it. And it also made Morgan oh so sad. Oh, it was wonderful.
I just wanted to do the thing, man. I just...
Every time Morgan cries, an angel gets its wings.
Did you say you had a favorite moment from the season,
Steve? Yeah, when you killed yourself.
Oh, okay. What about you, Tommy? Did you say?
I don't know if I did, but I mean, my favorite was probably the $100 budget episode, my first win on the channel, and it was my Shrines deck, which...
Actually, it wasn't your first win on the channel, the first because one was you won Lord the Lord of the Rings episode.
That wasn't part of the season, though, was it?
No, but it was your first win on the channel.
Okay, fair. Yeah, okay, my first win of the season was that. But I still just... That game was fun, and while Isshin may be my favorite commander, that is probably... Of the current forms of all my decks, that's probably my favorite deck. Because Isshin, while he's a cool commander, the version of the deck I have right now is kind of jank, and I need to upgrade it to make it a lot better. That was a fun one.
I think my favorite game of the season was Uncommon Commanders.
That was
I got
game.
To play that when we both had Cultivator Colossus. That was
crazy.
But I got to play the big stompy green stuff, which I didn't get to do as much this season. It's always fun to go up against Tatio. I mean, it's stupid, but I love it. But
everyone had a good game that game.
It was a fun game, and then I also think Revenge Week was up there too.
Steven's like, the two games I won, like, yeah. Those are the...
Well, but they were great games, though. I'm not just saying that because...
In Steven's defense, the games that I talked about were you games that games I won, well. So, I mean...
It's almost like...
Tommy talked about was the game that he won.
It's almost like winning the game is fun.
What was your favorite game that you did not win?
Oh, by... Far the Christmas one. Oh,
I'd probably say Christmas.
Where I immediately died and was just shocked and heartbroken the rest of the game.
I won that episode, so I can't say the Christmas episode, but that was a really fun game.
What was the best time I killed myself?
I was going to say, they were all pretty good.
It's hard to pick, and I have a terrible memories, so it all just like...
When we were playing with Jason's decks and I had the least, like, I was going to hit you for, like, massive damage, and you're like, I'm just going to kill myself instead.
Yeah. Nope. Well, guys, thank you for supporting the show. Thanks for sticking around. Thanks for checking out this video as well. If there's any episodes from Season 2, maybe even Season 1 if you really want to go back, that you haven't seen, make sure you do that. We'll have a link to the playlist somewhere here at the end of the video, or in the description, or it's on the front page of our YouTube channel. Make sure you're subscribed if you're not already, though you're probably not seeing this video if you're not subscribed. But hope you guys are excited for what's coming next. We have a lot of really cool themes and really cool decks that we're working on. So we will see you guys soon. Bye.
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 Wow.
So nasty.